Hello, everybody. Thank you for the kind invitation. And it's a really pity that I cannot join personally such a meeting. I was so happy 2 years ago to be personally also with my wife visiting the wonderful country of India for the past meeting. I hope to have the chance again very soon to be live in your country. Anyhow, today, I will share with you the new evidence about glucose variability and cardiovascular complications of diabetes. These are my conflicts of interest. You know very well from the DCCT edict that in this study, the role of hyperglycemia in conditioning the development of a cardiovascular complication was clarified. In type 1 diabetes, intensive blood glucose control is able to reduce the risk for cardiovascular disease, so showing that if you control glycemia, you can also get some benefit in reducing cardiovascular risk. And similarly, in type 2 diabetes, the UK PDS, and particularly the long-term follow-up, was also able to show the benefit of controlling hyperglycemia, in this case, in type 2 diabetes. This, you know, several trials were planned to confirm that intensive glucose control can protect people with diabetes from cardiovascular disease. The results were somehow disappointing. You know, the problem of the accord where an increase in total mortality was shown in the intensive arm treatment. But if you look at the several meta-analyses, I'm just showing one of the most famous, you see that when all the studies are combined, and it's clear that a good glycemic control can have some benefit even when or a previous cardiovascular event is already present. You see here in this meta-analysis, the impact of intensive control, the glycemic control on non-fatal myocardial infarction, and there is and the total mortality is not affected. So in other words, it seems that optimizing glucose control can help to prevent cardiovascular disease in diabetes. Over here, we learned that A1C is considered the gold standard to assay the glycemic control in diabetes. You see here is a study who tried to find a correlation between A1C and the level of a fasting glycemia in order to somehow predict what means A1C in terms of a glycemic control, particularly in terms of glycemia. So the question is, if A1C is the gold standard of glycemic control and represent really the overall glycemic control of people with diabetes. If somebody with the type 1 diabetes, meaning without any other concomitant comorbidities, you know, type 1 diabetes, they are often young, without insulin resistance, without high blood pressure, dyslipidemia, so on. So if in people with type 1 diabetes, A1C is always in good range, meaning under control, you do not expect any impact on complication. In other words, if A1C is represented the gold standard of overall glycemic control, in the life of a type 1 diabetes, you have always a good control in terms of A1C in the range, you do not expect the appearance of complications. But this is not the case. The Swedish Diabetes Registry, which is a very important long-term study of including overall almost all the Swedish population, was able to show that even in people having type 1 diabetes, having almost all the life a good A1C, the incidence of a cardiovascular event was anyhow higher than a control, meaning that probably A1C is not enough to catch all the aspects of a glycemic control. And clearly, this is the logical conclusion of this data. So you know that in normal people, after the meal, glycemia does not go higher than 140. It's always under control. But in diabetes, the situation is different. After the meal, you can have a huge increase of glycemia. And IDF, several years ago, published specific guidelines looking at the effect of postprandial hyperglycemia, not only on cardiovascular events, but also in terms of impact on overall glycemic control. And the recommendation of a level, which was a level 1+, meaning very high level of recommendation, was that targeting both postprandial plasma glucose and fasting plasma glucose is an important strategy for achieving optimal glycemic control. And usually, we measure glycemia after the meal, after 2 hours. But recently, it has been proposed that the glycemia after 1 hour could be even more dangerous than the glycemia after 2 hours. A huge amount of literature is already or today supporting this evidence. And the explanation seems to be very simple. And it is because after 1 hour, usually glycemia is higher than after 2 hours. So having high glucose level after 1 hour, you can expect that this is more dangerous than what you see after 2 hours. But it's surprising that what we do in the preclinical practice, just measure glycemia after the meal after 2 hours. Why? Because if you have already existing guidelines from ADA, AACE, IDF, you see that the recommendation is to measure glycemia at 1 hour, an hour and a half, never at 2 hours. So what do you do usually in clinical practice is not fitted, it does not fit with what is reported in the guidelines. And probably this must should be considered for the future. Anyhow, so we have a first proof that A1C is not enough. You must also consider postprandial hyperglycemia if you want to catch other aspects of glycemia. These are real data from real life in type 1 diabetes. You see this, in this population, the mean A1C is very good. It's 6.7%. So you could be happy. But this is not the case. Using continuous glucose monitoring, you see how glycemia goes up and down, showing a huge variability over the day. And even having a good A1C, this does not mean that the glycemia is under a good control. And the first study reporting that this variability of blood glucose can be an independent risk factor for cardiovascular mortality was published more than 20 years ago from an Italian group from Verona. They were able to show that the variability of fasting glucose in years, in, let's say 10 years, was predicting high risk of cardiovascular mortality in type 2 diabetes. After this, we had several epidemiological studies, but all this evidence has been confirmed in the post-hoc analysis of several well-known clinical trials. You find the confirmation that the glucose variability is a risk factor, particularly for cardiovascular disease in type 2 diabetes, in the advanced, in the DVO, the VADT, the EMPA-REG, all HART, and the ACCORD. So the evidence is very, very strong. And this is why a couple of years ago, we published this review just showing all the aspects just justifying why glucose variability must be considered an independent risk factor for cardiovascular and microvascular complications in diabetes. However, the story is, not ending with the glucose variability, because today we have other markers of glucose control, particularly is emerging the value of the so-called glucose timing range, meaning how much time somebody spends in normal range of glycemia over the day. And this is very important to understand to the meaning. Why? Because you see here three situations in which with the same A1C, the timing range is very different. And according to the percent spent in this range of good glycemic control, you see that somebody could be considered in poor or excellent glycemic control, not just. So meaning that A1C is really not enough to understand the situation of somebody. Another information is that when you use SMBG to check the glucose control, it's like, again, it's not enough. While if you use continuous glucose monitoring, you can get information that otherwise you can lose using simply SMBG. So today we have evidence that time in range, particularly using CGM, could be very, very helpful in understanding the overall glycemic control of people with diabetes. And why this is important is immediate to understand that if somebody is in normal control, this is good. But we have already evidence linking that the level of time in range with the risk of complications, including cardiovascular complications. More time is spent in the range of glycemia, better is the situation in terms of complications. And this is not true only for diabetes. You see here that in this study performed in a critical care setting, people without diabetes who spent in the range of glucose between 70 and 140 mg/dL, more than 80% of the stay in the hospital, had a better prognosis than the others not having this condition. However, when we speak about glucose variability, we usually think about the peaks, but the glucose variability also means valley in terms of risk of hypoglycemia. And evidence shows that high variability of glycemia is linked to high risk of hypoglycemic episodes. And we know very well that hypoglycemia by itself is a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. This emerged by several studies. I'm just showing the one of the most newer study, the ADVANCE. You see here that higher was the percent of hypoglycemia, higher was the risk for cardiovascular complications. But what probably is less known is that hypoglycemia is also an independent risk factor for progression of atherosclerosis. So any episode of hypoglycemia also accelerates the risk of atherosclerosis. And this must be also taken account when you plan the therapy, because avoiding hypoglycemia is a very important strategy in order to also avoid the risk for not only for cardiovascular event, but also for the progression of atherosclerosis. However, I'm sorry, it's a never-ending story. Why? Because, okay, if you are very good, careful, and anyhow you have an episode of hypoglycemia, it's very important how you recover from hypoglycemia. In this study performed in cells and in rats, you see that inducing hypoglycemia and recovering with hyperglycemia was accompanied by a worsening situation, particularly by a huge increase of oxidative stress. But this is true not only for cells and animals, but also for humans, unfortunately. In this study published some years ago, we were able to show that if you induce hypoglycemia, there is a worsening of endothelial function, an increase of oxidative stress and inflammation. And if you recover inducing hyperglycemia, the situation is worsens, is not improving. So this means that also today is very important how you recover from hypoglycemia and must be avoided the increase producing hyperglycemia post hypoglycemia. I don't know if I convinced you that when we speak about the glycemic control today, something's very different, just only considering A1C. But I believe that the story of glucose variability, time in range, is strongly supported by this evidence. In this study, healthy normal people were wearing a continuous glucose monitoring continuously for 1 month. that the evidence is that in normal people, glycemia never goes up 140 or down 70 milligram deciliter. And my explanation is that this is not happening because otherwise any spike is very dangerous. The nature spends a lot of energy to keep glucose in a strict narrow range, always in the life of human beings. And the meaning, my opinion, is that otherwise any swing could be very dangerous. So, dear colleague, today, the approach of the perfect management of hyperglycemia is a little bit more complex than we believed only a few years ago. A1C alone is not enough. Fasting glucose is not enough, but you need to be as much as possible in the range of a normal glucose to avoid short-term and long-term glucose variability, to control postprandial hyperglycemia either at 1 hour, an hour, 1 hour, and 2 hours, and to avoid hypoglycemia. And if this happens, to be careful how you recover from hypoglycemia, avoiding the production of a hyperglycemia. So this is the situation today. Clinically complicated, I understand, it's so complicated to almost normalize the glycemia of people with diabetes in order to get the best. But the evidence is there. This is a science, and so is why we able to confirm this. Thank you very much.